Happy Sabbath and welcome back for another week of our online worship experience together. I want to let you know that I've been having conversations with each of our boards at the three different churches, and we are currently discussing and going over the conference's recommendations for resuming worship services. We have not set a date yet for when we're going to return to our worship services, but we will keep you informed. We will keep you in the loop. This morning, our message is entitled Now and Later. And so I want to just invite you to bow your heads with me before we open the word. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for another Sabbath. We ask that as we study your word today, your Holy Spirit would comfort our hearts and enlighten our minds. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. In the 2000 movie Castaway, Tom Hanks plays Chuck Noland, a time-focused systems analyst who travels the world resolving productivity issues at FedEx depots. At the beginning of the movie, we see a portrait of a man who is time and task obsessed. He has a good job and a good relationship with Kelly, whom he is planning a life with in Memphis. They want to get married, but his busy life can get in the way, as we see him preparing to take what is supposed to be a short business trip over the Christmas holiday. Kelly drops him off at the airport. He proposes to her in the car just before boarding his flight, and they lament the fact that they won't get to spend the holiday together. While flying over the South Pacific, Chuck's plane goes down in a harrowing crash, and he becomes the aircraft's sole survivor. The waves carry his lifeboat to an isolated tropical island, and over the next 4 years, life as he knows it comes to a screeching halt. He goes from conquering the modern world to languishing in frustration and despair. From being a competent business leader to struggling just to hydrate and stay warm at night. From being surrounded by people that love and respect him to talking to a volleyball as his only friend. Overnight, he goes from prosperity in all areas of his life to total deprivation. Eventually, Chuck gets rescued, and he makes his way back to Memphis only to find that he had been given up for dead. Kelly has married someone else and has started a family. The irony is revealed. The deadline-consumed, time-obsessed man is forced to see that time has passed him by. But we see that the island experience has changed him. His response shows that he has been impacted by what he has experienced. He's not mad. He is accepting of what he has lost. In the second to last scene of the movie, Chuck is sitting in a therapist's chair, reflecting on what he has learned. He states that he is going to go on living, that he's going to live in the moment. He's going to face the reality of right now, content in the present circumstances, and aware of the fact that realities can change in a moment. Later can make all the difference. So he's going to be open to whatever new possibilities life may bring. As his father once told him, because tomorrow the sun will rise. Who knows what the tide could bring? Contentment in the moment, whatever our circumstances may be, with an open eye and heart to new possibilities on the horizon. How do we get that? It seems to me that that's exactly what we need to get through the odd times, the unorthodox seasons, the tough spots, and the hard years. It all starts with contentment in the here and now. Writing from his Roman imprisonment, the Apostle Paul explains to the Philippians that he has experienced both highs and lows in his life, and that he has learned how to exist in all such moments. He says in Philippians 4:12, I know how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Abounding doesn't seem like such an undesirable prospect for most of us, right? But the suffering, the need part, the experiencing distress part, not so great. That can sometimes seem unbearable. Paul goes on to explain how he is able to bear it all in all times. He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God's provision of day-by-day grace in Christ enabled Paul to be content while either filled or hungry, to while he is either prospering or suffering, to have abundance and to go wanting. He says, I can do all things. And this really means all things, not just easy things. All things means through Christ, I can hunger and suffer and be in want. I can experience loss, injustice, and pain. This puts the stunning promise of Philippians 4:19 in its proper light when he goes on to say, my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. What does every need of yours mean in view of Philippians 4:11 to 12? It means all that you need for God glorifying contentment, which may include times of hunger and need. Paul's love for the Philippians flowed from his contentment in God and not from his circumstances. His contentment flowed from his faith in God's infallible provision of grace in Christ to be all he needed in times of both plenty and in times of need. Paul could say, I know that I have everything in Christ always in my present reality, and I can go through all things through the Christ who strengthens me in this present moment. He doesn't say in verse 19 that God will supply all your wants. No, he says he will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Apparently, even when Paul experiences temporal and emotional need, he knows that God has already supplied Christ Jesus to him, the source of all grace in one person, and so he can be content. He can live in the present situation and be content. The Bible Dictionary says in reference to this, that being content means being satisfied to the point where you are not disturbed or disquieted. It doesn't say satisfied to the point where you don't want change, but satisfied for now until God brings the change. Just a few verses back in Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7, Paul sheds more light on this kind of contentment by saying, have no anxiety about anything, but in all things, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, continue to let God know what you want. And the peace that passes understanding shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Paul is saying, don't be upset about anything, no matter what is happening. Pray about it. Tell God your need. While you are waiting for God to move, be a very thankful and grateful person for all that God has already done for you. And if God never does one more thing for us, brothers and sisters, then the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ is more than enough for us to be content over, isn't it? This kind of contentment brings about unexplainable peace. Being thankful from the heart is necessary for the receiving of God's continued favors in our lives. Verse 7 is telling us, number one, have no anxiety or care. Number two, tell God your need. And number three, be thankful before anything changes. Then you will have tremendous peace and contentment no matter what state you are in, while you are waiting for God to work out His will in your life. So we want to be content in the here and now. But that's just half of our equation today. We also want to be open to the new opportunities that will come in the very soon later. We are able to do this when we keep the ebb and flow of life in perspective. Solomon in the book of Ecclesiastes talks about the way that life goes through this rhythm of ups and downs. Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, to everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to gain and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. There's something about these famous words of King Solomon that I want you to understand. In the book of Ecclesiastes, where we find these words, Solomon shows us what it is like to experience life here in this world. He allows us to see his own struggle with it all, and the literary style that he uses contrasts experiencing life under the sun, as he calls it, with a life aware of the gift of God, which is his presence. In the book, under the sun always means experiencing life without the awareness of God's presence. He writes entire sections bemoaning and bewailing what life is like under the sun. He says that under the sun, in other words, life experience without God, under the sun, there is no justice. It is unfair. There is no rhyme or reason. There is despair and hopelessness. But then, what the genius of Solomon does is that he contrasts this experience of life under the sun with the experience of life not under the sun, but under heaven. In these sections of the book, he reveals that he perceives that the gift of God is there. In these parts of Ecclesiastes, Solomon lifts the veil and shows us that sometimes in our moments of spiritual clarity and awakening, we perceive that the gift of God, God Himself, is actually present in this life. And so the book seems a bit bipolar as Solomon contrasts experiencing life under the sun with spiritual awareness and life under heaven, recognizing that the gift of God is there. The beauty of the famous passage of Ecclesiastes that we just read is that this is one of the sections of the book where Solomon is saying the gift of God, his presence, is actually here. So in other words, in the time to be born and in the time to die, God is present in both. Yes, God is there in the times of laughing and dancing, but he is also there when it is time to weep and to mourn. He's there when it's time to gain, but he's also there when it's time to lose. The wisest man that ever lived tells us that the gift of God is in these moments as well. In other words, God is near to you, not just in the good times, but in the sad times, the lonely times, the missing other people times, the sick times, the jobless times, the hard times. And from what we've learned is that in perceiving him drawing near to us in those times, that's when we learn beyond a shadow of a doubt that God truly loves us, that he is our forever friend, that he doesn't leave us with just hard times. No matter what kind of time you're in, the ebb and flow of life's tide continues. This is why when you're in a hard time, you've got to stay optimistic, knowing that the tide is coming back in soon enough. You must keep your eyes open to whatever new possibilities it's going to bring with it. The closing sequence of the movie Castaway shows Chuck traveling into the Texas countryside to deliver the very last unopened FedEx package that he was holding onto from his unplanned trip to that lonely deserted island. The house at the address is empty, so he leaves the package at the door with a note saying that the package saved his life. He departs and drives down a short distance down the road, stopping at a four-way intersection. He gets out of his car, spreads out his map on the hood of his car, and we see him there at a crossroad. A beautiful woman passing by in a pickup truck sees him standing outside of his car, searching his map, and she stops to explain where each of the roads leads. There's this brief moment of chemistry between them, and then she gets back into her truck. She drives away. As she's driving away, Chuck notices that the business logo on her truck matches the one on the parcel he just dropped off. He looks down each of the roads in front of him, then back to the road the woman just took, and he smiles, recognizing what the tide just brought in. Brothers and sisters, life is full of ups and downs, twists and turns, good times and bads. It's like the tide. It goes out and it comes back in again. May you come to know that Jesus, the gift of God, is with you in the now and in the later. May you be content in the now, and may you also have open eyes and an open heart to whatever newness later will carry in, whenever that later arrives. May you be content now and content then, knowing that the gift of God is with you at all times. And if you're in one of those ebbs of life, may you rest assured that this is momentary, because tomorrow, the sun will rise. Who knows what the tide could bring? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the fact that you are with us in all times. May we have the peace that passes understanding and be content in all times of our lives. And may we have open eyes and an open heart, ready to receive whatever new thing later is going to bring when the tide comes in. We thank you in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us. God bless you.